And so we have made it to lesson 14 and my favorite type of photography, which is wildlife photography. This is what I really enjoy doing. I love taking and spending time sitting out in the woods by myself for sometimes an hour or two or more, just listening to the birds, sitting there motionless, watching, listening, waiting to see what comes around in order or volunteering itself to have its photo taken. There are a lot of different tricks and tips that you can use to become a better wildlife photographer, and we're going to go over a lot of these here in this lesson. First thing I want to encourage you to do is start small. It doesn't really matter, the tricks you use is the tools you use and approaches that you use for wildlife photography on little things are the same exact techniques you're going to use on them for big things. A lot of things about using concealment, using very slow motions, watching your noise, all that's going to come together in both large and small objects. And if you can learn to do it on the small things that are around your house, then you can also master using it on larger items or larger animals out in the woods. If you're wondering why this sea turtle has a red glow on it, it's because when they're hatching, when you cannot shine a white light on them. The white light disorients them, and it also reflects on the water, causing the predators in the water, the other fish, to come up to the shore and up to the surface, so that when the baby sea turtles make their mad dash from their nest into the water, there's predators there waiting for them. So instead, the federal government requires us to use red lights when we're working with our baby sea turtles. Going back to the idea of starting small, think about a frog. Have you ever tried to catch a frog or catch a lizard? The movements that you use to sneak up on that frog or sneak up on that lizard are the same exact movements, the same exact techniques that you would use to photograph larger items, larger wildlife. How you look at it, how you move towards it. Very slow, very stealthy. No sudden movements, no sudden noise. Everything has to be smooth. And if you can do it to a frog or a lizard, then you can also do it with larger animals. I've actually been able to move slowly enough that I was able to sneak up on a flying squirrel that was in my bird feeder at night and pet its tail. I got two nice strokes on its tail before the squirrel realized that it was being touched and scurried away. Learn the habits of your subject before you go out to shoot it. For example, this big alligator is about a 13-foot long gator, real beast of a machine. And it was in the Gulf Oak Ridge gator hole. When I took that photo, I was probably only about 12 to 15 feet away from the alligator, which is pretty dang close to something of that size, particularly considering I was literally sitting a foot from the edge of the water where it was at. But I know alligators. I've done a lot of research on them. I've spent a lot of time working with them. I've even got to wrestle a few of them. Alligators, a big bull gator like that, is not going to tolerate another bull gator, another male gator, being in its area. And where its area was that particular day really wasn't its area. You see, that photo was taken during breeding season, and he was visiting one of the girls in his harem. The big bull gators don't like small ponds where this one was. They prefer much larger, deeper bodies of water. But every May time frame, the bulls will start working a 2-square-mile area, visiting all the girls in their harem, and after they get done servicing them, then they move on to the next hole looking for more females to entertain. In this situation, I was able to see the female, which was about a 6-foot gator, and I was able to see this male. I knew where both of them were. I knew she was the only female in the pond, and I knew he would not allow another male to be in the pond as well. As long as I could see them, I was good, assuming they didn't start making threatening movements. If he started inflating his body, vibrating his body so that he was literally shaking water drops around him, showing more aggressive stance, it would have been time for me to get out of there. Also, if he had bottomed out going underwater, I would have been gone in a hurry, because once he went under that dark water, I couldn't see him and I wouldn't know where he would have come back up at. Same thing here for the black bear. I had wanted to start towards the end of last summer, decided I wanted to go shoot some black bear. So I convinced my wife to take me up to the Gatlinburg area, because when I started doing my research on the black bears, I learned that the Gatlinburg area of the Smoky Mountains was one of the best places to find black bear. So we drove up there for a short weekend and spent, I think, 3 nights in a nice hotel right there on the strip. Got out into Cades Cove area, where people encouraged us to go look for black bears, and there this one was. But along with learning about where to find the black bears, I also had to learn about their behaviors. What do they do when they're threatened? What do they do when they're aggressive or acting aggressively? How do you defend yourself against an aggressive black bear? Which basically you fight them with everything you've got, because the minute you quit fighting, you die. That was on the federal website for the black bear information. They say the black bear attacks you, fight it with every ounce of energy you have. Now, the next tip, keeping a safe distance, seems pretty obvious for things like bears and alligators, but not so much for the next critter I'm going to show you. Along with keeping a safe distance for yourself, of course, yes, this fellow here you definitely want to keep a safe distance from. Let's talk about him for a second. This is an eastern diamondback, which are very rare in our area. In fact, the federal government has even started looking at putting them on the endangered species list. Now, I always like to ask people, is this snake behaving aggressively? And most folks say, well, yeah, it's behaving aggressively. It's all bowed up, big and bad, ready to strike. Its tail shaking there. You can tell that by the blurring of the tail. Of course it's behaving aggressively. Well, in reality, it is not behaving aggressively. It is behaving defensively. That snake was not chasing me down. It was not striking at me. It was not trying to attack me. It did not get up that morning and say, I'm going to go find a human and bite them. Not at all. In fact, when it saw me, it did exactly what it was supposed to do. It pulled off to the side of the trail, bowed up real big, and started shaking its tail at me, saying, hey, dude, look, I'm here, I'm big, I'm scary, don't I look evil? Look at my tail. Here it is, shaking and rattling all over the place. If you mess with me, I'm going to bite you. You have a choice. You can turn around and walk away, or you can stay and we can fight. It's entirely up to you. The snake's not being aggressive, it's being defensive. And once again, while keeping a safe distance from alligators and bears and rattlesnakes is kind of an obvious thing, it's not so obvious for our next critter, the bald eagles. You see, the bald eagle is not really a threat to people, but people are a huge threat to it. Federal government says that you cannot be closer than 330 feet or 100 meters from an active bald eagle nest. This is really important for you to know as a photographer, because most photographers don't have lenses big enough to get good pictures of that bald eagle nest. So instead, they take and walk right up to the nest. What happens then is the parents become scared and get stressed. They may not lay an egg there if they're too stressed. They may abandon the nest. They may abandon the nest with a live young in it and never come back. Historically, an eagle will go to the same nest year after year. This particular nest they've been coming to about 8 years now inside Gulf State Park. Every year, come back to the same exact place. and raise their young. Just because the animal is not a threat to you, it doesn't mean you're not a threat to them. So when you're learning about your subject, learn the laws about how to protect it. When birds are on nests, don't go creeping up to real close to them so you can get pictures of them on their nest, because you're going to scare them away and they may end up abandoning the nest and abandoning the young and then costing the lives of their chicks. And the same thing goes for other wildlife as well. When you do wildlife photography, your goal is to be invisible. You don't want to do anything that is going to change the behavior of the animals you're photographing. Next tip is to use a big, bright lens. How big of a lens? As big of a lens as you can afford. For years I shot with a 1,000mm antique Nikkor lens, but it was a totally manual lens that only shot on f11. She's a great lens, but she's a finicky old girl. Then I was fortunate enough to get my hands on a 500mm Canon L series lens with a 1.4 extender to go with it. That gave me the power of 720mm, and the lens was good enough quality that I was getting pictures that were pretty much comparable to the 1,000mm, while at the same time having the added bonus of autofocus to go with it and more aperture range. With a big lens in mind, this one here I shot at 200mm. At that point of my photography career, it was the biggest lens I had, and that is of a ruby-throated hummingbird. To get that photo, I stood on the roof of my wife's work van with the camera on the tripod and took the photo. Now, regretfully, I did get closer than I should have to the nest. We actually went up to the nest. We were kind of dumb and stupid at that point. We went up to the nest, which was about the size of a soda bottle cap, and looked inside, and there were two tiny Jelly Belly jelly bean size eggs inside of it. Backed off from it, stood on the roof of her van, and stood very still and waited, and the mama hummingbird came back to look in, to sit on her nest, and that's when I got that photograph. But remember what I said, your goal is not to capture an amazing image. Your goal is to capture an amazing image without having an impact on the wildlife. In this case, the mama kept coming back. It wasn't a big deal, but we want to make sure we're not doing something to disrupt their natural behavior. Just like shooting children, you want to get down on your subject's level, even if they're big, furry kitty cats. Now, how awesome would that be? I had taken and told this story to one of my early photography classes, and a few days later, somebody sent me the photo and asked me if this is what I meant by getting down on their level, and just had to include it. Wouldn't that be the most awesome thing to do, to get to do, having a big old, I guess that's a leopard cuddle up next to you, maybe a cheetah, not really sure how you tell the difference. And isn't this the cutest thing you ever did see? It is a juvenile great horned owl, or owlet, that kept jumping down out of his tree. Look at the size of the feet and the beak on that thing. Its feet and beak grow first, and then the body grows into it. This critter here was at the golf course at Gulf State Park, and it kept jumping out of its tree, and then Kelly would put it back in his tree. The next day it jumped back down. This went on for several days until it finally decided to stay put, until it was big enough to start fledging. Same thing goes for turtles, like this diamondback terrapin, which is on the threatened species list. It was brought to me by one of my students who had found it walking across their driveway, and they didn't know what to do about it, but they knew that it wasn't in a safe spot there, so they brought it to me. I got a couple quick photos of it, and then I gave it to my wife, who saw to it that it was released back into the wild in its native environment. The diamondback terrapin is the only species of turtle that lives exclusively in brackish water. We mentioned this before, but moving slowly is a very important thing with wildlife photography. I had seen this pig frog at the Gulf Oak Ridge Gator Hole and wanted to get its photo, and it was only a few feet away from the side of the pond. You can see I was shooting with a 1-400mm lens, and I only zoomed in to 310mm, so he wasn't that far away from me. I had the lens on a tripod, which made things even more complicated, and I had to move myself, my camera, and my tripod very slowly and very gently around a tree, down a slope, so I was sitting right on the edge of the water in order to get a good low angle and get that photograph of the frog and its reflection in the pond there. Another good tip for shooting wildlife photography, just like shooting landscape photography, is you want to get up early. I have teenagers. The first thing teenagers want to do when they get out of bed is eat. They must have food. They're going to die if they don't have food, like now. Well, animals are the same way. They've been asleep all night long. They get up in the morning, and the first thing they want to do is start working on breakfast. While they're eating, they're a whole lot more tolerant of you. Just like this raccoon that was working on its breakfast as I was kayaking in Mobile Bay, it allowed me to get within about 15 feet of it, and it wasn't stressed about me being there at all, just slowly creeped up on it. Or this, I believe it is a little blue heron, I believe is what that one is. Once again, you can see it's got the fish in its mouth. It was more concerned about getting breakfast than it was about the fact I was there taking photographs. Another advantage of getting up early is you get some good warm tones of light, and if you're trying to get birds in flight, you have a very low angle on the sun. This photo of the bald eagle flying was taken right after sunrise one morning. I knew where eagles were supposedly building a nest, and it was actually a secondary nest that they were building on an osprey stand. They had their primary nest a few miles away. So I got out there early one morning before the sun rose, got myself in position behind a blind of trees, and waited for the sun to rise. As the sun rose and cracked the horizon, the eagles started flying around and bringing in new sticks to go on top of their secondary nest. And with the sun being so low, I was able to get a shot of the eagle illuminated from the underside as it flew by me. Probably my favorite eagle in flight photograph I ever got. When you're shooting wildlife, another thing you really need is patience. Now, I mentioned earlier that sometimes I will sit for an hour or two in the woods just waiting. One day I had decided that I wanted to get pictures of fox squirrels at the golf course at Gulf State Park. And they're fox squirrels are really cool. They come in a variety of color combinations, from a very grayish color to a more reddish to a black color, all with white speckled in with them. So I went to the whole 13 area around Gulf State Park where the fox squirrels are known to be. And I chased those suckers all over that golf course, trying to get pictures of them. Every time I got almost close enough, it would take off and fly away again. And you can see at that point, I was shooting at a 200mm lens. That's the biggest lens I had. So I was trying to get close to them. Finally, I said, forget this. I started packing up to go, and that squirrel shimmied up the tree about 15 feet from me, stretched out, laid out, said, okay, dude, I'm done teasing you. How about this? Will this shot work for you? And allowed me to get that nice close shot of it stretched out there on the tree, just showing off for me. Same thing with this snowy plover. Snowy plovers are really neat birds. They're also very rare birds in our area, and the federal officials that were monitoring the nest took us out so that we'd get pictures of them and their young. This point I was shooting a 1-400mm lens, and myself and another wildlife photographer had been blessed to be escorted out to where they were nesting at to try and get some photos of them. We chased that dang bird all over the beach, and the plovers are kind of cool how they do this. Mama will stay with the kids, and Dad's going to come and get kind of close to you so you get distracted by him. And then as you start following dad away from the kid, mom and the kids, he's slowly leading you away, just kind of teasing you. And then when he feels like you're far enough away from the kids, he's going to fly off and abandon you again. So you can never get close enough to get a good photo. Well, once again, we chase this dang bird all over the darn beach. We finally had enough. We quit chasing them, started packing up our gear. We were standing there talking to the federal government official who was with us, our guide, and she's pointed out and said, hey, there it is, right over there. And the bird had gotten tired of, or gotten upset that we weren't playing tag with it anymore, and it walked within probably about 40 yards of us, allowing us to get a nice photo of it. Another example here, moving slowly to get close and being patient. I was in a kayak for this one, and as I wasn't moving at all, I was just drifting very slowly with the current. I'd make the slightest movements with my paddle in order to correct, and I slowly creeped up on this snowy egret as it was eating breakfast in Mobile Bay. This, once again, by moving so slow, allowed me to get very close to it, so I was able to get a good sharp image. And I think this may be my last wildlife tip, and it is to blend in. If you talk to die-hard birders, they will tell you, you don't have to wear camouflage to go birding. In fact, they get really uptight sometimes when they see photographers showing up in all kinds of camo gear and things of that nature, because you don't have to have all that stuff to go birding. Well, the way birding works, if you're trying to have yourself what they call a big year, where you're seeing how many birds you can see in a single year, the way the birding works is if they can identify the bird, they get credit for it. They don't even have to see it. All they have to do is hear it and be able to identify the bird from its sound, and they get credit for seeing that bird. That doesn't work with photography, where you have to be close in order to get a good sharp image. This photo is of a pied-billed grebe, and I tried numerous times to get pied-billed grebe photos, but any time I got anywhere close to them, they'd bloop, go under the water, and they'd surface at 40 yards away. I could never get in position to get a really good sharp photo. So one morning I decided that I'm going to get these things. I got a ghillie suit, and I parked where Rita's Ice is in Gulf Shores, and I start walking up Highway 59 dressed up like the swamp creature, carrying a tripod and camera. With that one was with a 1 to 400 millimeter lens on it, and I worked my way over to the Wade Ward Park. And I could see where the grebes were from a distance, and I slowly worked myself up to the bushy edges of the park, and then I slowly moved myself out from behind the bushes. Now, if you're not familiar with a ghillie suit, what it looks like is a walking bush. So as I was slowly moving out from behind the bushes, this grebe kept stopping and looking at me and wondering, why is that bush moving and what does it have with it? And it would stop and look for a minute, then it'd go back to eating. And then I'd move a little bit more, and it'd stop and look at me and say, why is that bush moving? And then say, okay, all's good, bush stop, and then it would start eating again. That allowed me to get in a position where I was able to get really close to the bird without disturbing its natural behavior, get some nice sharp photos of it with a 400 millimeter lens, and then I slowly drifted out the same way I drifted in. Remember, you don't want to startle them to get the pictures, but you also don't want to startle them when you're done. Let them enjoy peace, living in peace, and drift out as slowly and gently as you drifted in. What do I look like when I dress up as a ghillie suit? The answer is, well, come on, like that. Here I am in my kayak, with my kayak covered with camo netting and my ghillie suit on. I had ghillie material wrapped around my lens as well, which is allowing me to blend in very well to the surroundings and makes me look a whole lot less human and less threatening to the birds that are around me. Ah, yes, there's another tip. Forgot about this one. Really good tip. Talk to the locals when you go to a new area. Find out where the wildlife is. When we had gone to Cage Cove to look for the bears, my wife stopped to ask that one of the ladies doing maintenance there, where do you find the bears at? And they said, well, you can look here and here for the bears. This is where they've been seen. But you really need to ride to the other side of the mountain into North Carolina because there's elk feeding on the side of the road there. I had no idea there was even elk in the Smokies. Turns out that the elk had been extinct, but the federal government decided they were going to introduce the elk a few years ago and brought in, I think, 100 of them from Canada, reintroducing them to the United States. Every evening, the elk would come out of the woods and feed along the side of the roads in this certain part of the Smoky Mountains. And they would have volunteers, the elk volunteers, that would go out and stand on the side of the roads to keep the elk and the people separated from each other. And that was there more to protect the people than it was the elk, because, hey, people are stupid and would walk right up to it to try and get a better photo. And those antlers are made for more than just to get him looking pretty to the girls. So we made our trip over there. I was using my 500 millimeter prime lens, got some beautiful photos of the elk up there in the Smoky Mountains. Never would have known about their existence if we hadn't stopped to talk to the locals. Ah, there's another tip. Forgot about that one too. Really good tip for wildlife photography is that cars are invisible. That is a marsh rabbit. They live along Highway 135 in Gulf State Park, and I had tried many times to get their photos, and every time I'd stop and get out of the car, they'd scurry off into the weeds. So one day I was sitting at the red light there by the pier, and I realized that the rabbit was sitting right by me, and it just flat out didn't care that I was there. So I took and turned the truck around, came back in, and through the window of the truck was able to get a beautiful shot of the rabbit, and it was totally not bothered by me because I was in the car. As long as you stay in the car, you're invisible. One of the local birders down here, Janice Neitzel, gets some beautiful pictures of black-bellied whistling ducks and other birds just from the window of her car. As long as she stays in her car, she's invisible to them, and they don't see her as a threat. With that information, you should be ready to go out and start your career as a National Geographic wildlife photographer. Enjoy! You